This is Duke University Chapel.
Well, it seems that Jonah's greatest nightmare was that the sinners of Nineveh might actually repent. And he avoided going there, for it almost cost him his life. And it seemed like hellfire seemed like a better sermon than grace. But in the end, the good news is good, that God so loved the world. And I can remember the story of Evie Hill, the old African-American evangelist and preacher. And he said that when he would preach on Sunday morning, there was a little old lady that sat on the front row. He said they all called her Old 1800 because they weren't sure when she was born, but it had to be in the 1800s. And she would sit up on the front row, and as he preached about all the things that were wrong in the world, she would say, "Get to the good news." And he would preach about injustice and oppression, and she would murmur to herself, "Get to the good news, Pastor." And he would talk about what happened on Friday and the old rugged cross, and she would say, "Get to the good news." And then he would get to Sunday when Jesus rose from the dead, and she would stand up and say, "Now that's it. Preach, preach that, preacher." The good news is the core of the gospel, and it seems that Jonah's worst nightmare came true. The good news was more powerful than the bad. And in the end, mercy triumphed over judgment, and Nineveh repented. It says that even the king wore sackcloth. And there's a great line that the king has that we didn't read this morning, but he says, "Who knows? Maybe God will have compassion and not destroy us." And indeed, his dream came true, and it ticked Jonah off. It says that Jonah was displeased and angry with God. And Jonah says, "This is exactly why I didn't want to go. I knew that you were a God of grace and compassion, and you would save these idiots." And I think, you know, God sort of agrees that they are fools. God says, "Yeah, they're full of wickedness, and they don't even know their left hand from their right, but I love those idiots." And it seems that is the good news, that we have a God that loves us even as we're full of wickedness. And the message is one that even a wicked people can repent. Even Nineveh or America can beat our chest and say, "God, have mercy on us." And I am reminded that I've sort of learned the good news from people who have experienced the bad news a little bit, you know. And I know one of my friends in Philadelphia was a woman who had experienced the wickedness of people. She was a blind woman who had been in and out of homelessness, and she played the flute on the street. And one day, as she was playing the flute with her little cup out getting money, some teenagers came up and they got a can of Lysol. And of course, she couldn't see them coming, and they sprayed it in her eyes and in her face. And my friend and I were able to visit with her that night, and we were just so angry, you know. And we said, "Man, there are some nasty, wicked people in the world, aren't there?" And I'll never forget what she said. She said, "Oh, but there's some good ones too." And the good ones, you don't know them unless you've experienced the bad ones. And the bad ones make you thank God all the more for the good ones. You never know a good day until you've had a bad one. I think that the bad news that we hear all around us right now when you read the newspaper is a beautiful opportunity for the church to shine, for the good news to be so good today. That it seems like that's what's happening in the gospel story too, that the times are bad. I mean, John the Baptist just got put in jail from old King Herod. But it's funny that it says right after that, it says, after John was put in prison, Jesus preached the good news that the kingdom is near all over the town. That seems a little odd to me. You know, I sort of wonder if I got locked up and all my community mates were out in the streets going, "This is the day, this is," you know. I think that as we look a little closer, we see that Jesus knows the end of the story. And it's almost as if he's laughing at Herod, because he knows that in the end, mercy triumphs. And it's no coincidence, I think, that the first folks to leave everything to follow Jesus were the marginalized: teenagers, prostitutes, fishermen. Rome's dream had failed them, and they wanted something more to live for. And then the first folks to die for Jesus were martyrs that had nothing else to lose except for the heavy yoke that Rome had laid on their backs. And that good news is good news to the poor. But it spreads beyond that, and it can even reach the kings and the presidents. And I remember Gandhi, when one place Gandhi writes about his movement, and he says, "We knew that something was happening when not only were the folks on the streets wearing homespun clothes, clothes that they had made with their own hands," and he said, "but there were people in Parliament that were making their own clothes." That this movement of building a new society in the shell of the old one was spreading all over the land, because the good news is a call to liberation for the oppressed and the oppressors. It's a call to leave everything and be set free from the meaningless toil and the lifeless routine that we fill our days with. God is saving us from ourselves. God is liberating us from our possessions that have come to possess us. And we find perfect joy not by keeping all the stuff, but by giving it away. I met this one kid in India when I was there working with Mother Teresa and the sisters, and we would throw these street parties for the kids that were beggars on the street. And one day it was the birthday of one of the kids I had grown really close to, and it's about 100 degrees, so I'm thinking, what should I get him for his birthday? And thought, what better than an ice cream cone? So I get this kid an ice cream, and I take it to him, and I have no idea when he had had ice cream before, but he just stares at it and shakes. He's so excited, you know. and then his instinct is, this is too good to keep for myself. And he immediately yells at all the other kids, and he goes, "We've got ice cream!" And he goes, "Everybody gets a lick!" And he lines them up. And he goes down the line. He goes, your turn. We get full circle back to me. And then he goes, "Shane, you get a lick too." I got this whole spit phobia thing going, you know, but I kind of fake a lick. You know, I'm like, that's so good. But that kid knew the secret. He knew the secret that the best thing to do with the best things in life is to give them away. And that seems to fly in the face of so much that we hear in our culture and even in the church, with this self-centered, blessing-obsessed gospel of prosperity that's about what we can get from God. And if we're not careful, we lose the secret of God's liberation, which is, if you want to find your life, you got to give it away. There's that beautiful scene in the really weird movie Harold and Maude, where this young man is proposing to this quirky woman named Maude, and he gives her a ring as they're standing on the ocean, and he asks her to marry him, and she says, "Oh, this is a precious gift," and she looks at it, and then she flings it into the sea. And he's like, "What'd you do that for?" And she said, "I love that ring. Now I'll always know where it is." It's a strange way of looking at the possessions that we have. And yet I think it's that sort of winsomeness that we have in Jesus, this holy recklessness with the stuff of earth, that we just give it away because it is so good. That it's a lesson of how to look at things that I've learned from my neighbors. In North Philadelphia, I live in one of the most economically devastated neighborhoods. We've got 20,000 abandoned houses, and yet we've got 3,000 families that are waiting for housing. We've got 700 abandoned factories. It's just an industrial wasteland. And about a year and a half ago, one of those abandoned factories caught on fire, and it spread into our neighborhood. It burnt down all of our homes, the home where I was living, our community center, and about a dozen other houses. It displaced about 100 families. And I can remember as it happened, there was this incredible thing, though, that community just burst out of the struggle. The Red Cross ended up telling us that they had set up a shelter nearby, but then they said the weirdest thing happened. Nobody stayed in the shelter because everybody in your neighborhood opened their homes up. And I remember talking to one of my neighbors. I was like, "How are you doing?" And he said, "Pretty good, actually. The greatest thing happened last night." He said, "For the first time, I could see the moon because the factory had burnt down." I thought, what a strange way of thinking of this. That my friend actually made a mural of it, and it's got this guy looking at his house as it's almost burnt to the ground, and the moon's behind it, and there's a little caption above him that says, "Boy, isn't the moon beautiful?" And I think it's that kind of freedom that we hear called to in the Corinthian reading. It teaches us to live as if none of the stuff around us even existed. To live as if the world around us is fading away and won't last. And husbands, live as if you didn't have wives. Wives, live as if you didn't have husbands. And I guess that's real good news on some days. But you know that it's this call to know that there's something deeper at the core of everything, and this call to liberation, that I find it funny when people see that we've left a lot of the stuff to follow Jesus, and they're like, "Oh, it's so heroic, you know, you take a vow of simplicity," and I'm like, you must have never seen the pearl that we left everything for, you know, because we said no to some things, but we said yes to something so dazzling and so beautiful that it makes all the other stuff look like dung. You know, we've said no to the counterfeit peace of Rome, but we've said yes to the perfect peace of Jesus. We've said no to the myth of redemptive violence, but we've said yes to the truth of redemptive grace. We've said no to the illusion of independence, but said yes to the beautiful interdependence of the family of God. We've said no to the American dream, but we've said yes to a dream that burns much brighter. We've left everything for the pearl, but the things that we've left are like fool's gold. They're like those little cubic zirconians, you know. It's like that plastic jewelry, the counterfeit pearls, the stuff that's just gaudy and clutters us. And it's not about what we've left, but it's about what we've found. We've found a love that's worth saying yes to, and that's why they left their nets. That's why they died. They died because this Jesus is so beautiful. And as liberated people, I think that frees us up to laugh a little bit, because we can laugh at the jails because we know that we have a God that liberates the captives. We can laugh at the recession because we know our providence comes from somewhere else. And I love that story in Revelation about the fall of Babylon. And as Revelation tells of the fall of Babylon, it says, and there were two responses to the fall. There was the responses of the merchants who looked at up and they wept and they beat their chests and they said, "Oh, how could great Babylon fall?" And then there's the response of the angels. And it says the angels rejoiced and they said, "Fallen, fallen is the great whore, Babylon." And maybe the big question for us is, are we weeping with the merchants or laughing with the angels today? And in my neighborhood, I've learned to laugh. I think that poor folks get it because they can rejoice when the world around us seems to be falling apart. They can they're not too stunned when kings or presidents fail us, because they've never had much faith in Caesar's. The poor can laugh when Babylon falls because they know that the new Jerusalem is coming. They can laugh when markets collapse because they know their providence comes from God. And like the lilies and the sparrows, they have the freedom. They've never really trusted too much in a 401k or a 201k now. You know, there's that freedom that we're just praying for our daily bread. And one of my neighbors said, "Oh, we're going to make it through. God is still good. And besides, my people have been in a recession for a few hundred years." It's with that freedom that we say our hope today does not lie on Wall Street. Our hope doesn't rest in America. Our hope does not come from a new Caesar or even a new president, even a good one. Our hope today is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. On Christ, the solid rock, we stand. All other ground is sinking sand. Indeed, as we look around, all other ground is sinking sand, but Christ will live forever. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
This is Duke University Chapel.